It's light only.
And the lights.
No,
no. I mean to put them on. Yes. Yeah. No.
Which one?
The video is going to be dark if these are not on.
There is. We do not need to be on, then you can do it.
Which one?
No, these bulbs.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
So. It's okay?
No.
Sorry. This one?
Yes, and then this one.
Okay.
The first one.
The first one? Yes.
Ah, all of the
yes,
charm. Okay. Oh, sorry. Last year I remember that we had just some lights, not all. In fact, they say, okay, perfect. And, okay, slide on. And, okay. Just a moment, please. It's difficult to use it. Lo vedete? Ah, modalità schermo intero. Ok.
Control F.
Sorry. Ok. Geodesy is a science that study the figure and the gravity field of the Earth. With the word figure, we mean size, shape and orientation of the Earth. And another important task is the study of the variation of this quantity, of the figure and the gravity field of the Earth. And okay, this quantity are obtained through observation made on the Earth surface or from the space. Okay, it's a very old science because the study of the figure of the Earth is at the base for the mapping and navigation and surveying application. Mapping, when we produce a mapping, a map of Earth, we are going to reproduce the figure of the Earth in a plane. So we have some relationship between, for instance, the ellipsoid that represent a reference surface of the Earth to a plane. So this is a very old science and was born just for very practical problem. Now, an important task are the changes in the shape and in the geometry of the Earth and also in the gravity field of the Earth, because we have some very important task. For instance, we want to study the polar ice melting. That is a very important issue that it's a really study in the last decades. And also we use to use this type of information also to study hydrological problem. For instance, we are going to see in detail, but this is an example from a paper that this is Greenland, and they compare the melting day anomaly, the day with the increase in the melting of the ice, with the uplift recorded by the GPS station. All these stations around the coast are GPS stations. So, okay, I think that you have already an idea what is a GPS. A GPS is a technique that give us position, is used for the positioning. Is in all our modern mobile phone, we have a GPS for geolocalization. So using this data, we can have information about the deformation of the crust. And this is an example of the GPS the deformation recorded with the GPS data can be used also for study related to the ice melting and so on. Okay, in January in geodesy we have two types of formulation. When we speak about figure of the Earth, we are speaking about the geometry of the Earth, the dimension of the Earth, the orientation in the space, and of course the shape we use to approximate the Earth with a plane if you are working in a very short with a very short distance, or with a sphere, or with an ellipsoidal. So these are geometry formulation. But when we speak about gravity field, we need to speak we need a physical formulation of the problem, because the gravity field is related to we are going to see to the gravitational field of the Earth and to the rotation of the Earth. We have two different formulations, but these formulations are related together because the gravity field shape the Earth. We know that the Earth is not a sphere, but it is an ellipsoid, and so on. And so we are going to see that we are going to have two different problems, but this problem can be merged together. And to solve this problem, to determine the figure of the Earth and its gravitational field, we need to solve geodetic boundary value problem. That means that we have data just on the boundary of the on the surface of the Earth and outside the surface of the Earth, and this is our condition. And using this, we are going to see that using this type of problem, we can solve the geodetic problem for the geometry and but also for the gravity. We can have information about geometry of the Earth but also for the gravity field. Okay. And inside, no, because it's not it's inside the harmonic domain of the gravity field, so we cannot solve the problem. We are going to see this. We don't have gravity measure inside the Earth. We put our instrument on the surface, on the space outside the Earth, and we invert this information to have information of the Earth. So it's a boundary. The boundary is given by the surface. Okay, we are going to see. So what do we, I speak about gravity field. What is a gravity field? We are going to see that it's given by the gravitational field plus the centrifugal field of the Earth. Because, okay, the gravitational field, we know that if you have a mass m in a point q of the space, it produces a gravitational field. And the gravitational field in the point P is given by this well-known relationship with the G universal constant of gravitation. But we can, this field admits a potential. So we speak about gravitational potential. And the relationship between the gravitational potential and the force is given by this relationship. The force is the gradient of the potential. Okay. We can we have seen the gravitational field produced by a mass M, but we can have a body, not just a single mass. And the relationship is really. I know that you already know all this equation, and you have an integral on the mass because we sum the effect of every infinitive element of the mass. And we can express the mass in terms of density. This is important. So the gravity field of the Earth is related to the density of the Earth. And okay. But when the Earth is a rotating body, so we have to take into account also for the centrifugal potential, the centrifugal field, because all our instruments are on the Earth and are rotating. So we have also the centrifugal force, that if you put, this is the rotation axis, if we use, for instance, Cartesian coordinate, the centrifugal force is given by this relationship. And also the centrifugal force admit a potential, the centrifugal potential. And this is the angular velocity of the Earth. So the gravity field is the sum of these two gravity fields, the gravitational and centrifugal field. This is important because we use to speak about, we confuse sometimes gravity and gravitational. But in geodesy it's clear, we are speaking about gravity, so the sum of these two quantities. And of course, also the gravity, the gravity field emit a potential, and this is related to the gravity force, that using this relationship. So the potential, the gradient of the gravity potential. Okay. Now. So we have discussed about the one topic of the geodesy, about the gravity field. Now we are going to see.
Can you just go to the previous slide? No, next one. Yeah. WP is gravity field, yeah?
Yes. It's the sum of the gravitational field and gravitational field and centrifugal field.
So grad of W would be force. Force?
Yes. So this is the potential, this is the force.
Okay. There is no negative because the gravitational force is attractive.
Yes. Sorry, at the beginning, probably I skip this slide. You are going to see this in the repository of my lesson. At the end of the syllabus, I put also some bibliographic reference. And Okay, after I'm going to show you at the end of the lesson. I put the name of a book that you can find in the Marie Curie library, also in a digital version, so it's easy to share if you have so if you have some double, you want to go in detail, you can also use this book. At the end I'm going to show you which one. Okay, the figure of the heart. The physical surface of the heart is a border between the solid and fluid masses and the atmosphere. So the ocean floor are included in this in the figure of the heart. Okay, the solid heart has a very irregular surface, so we cannot we are not able to express this figure in terms of a closed form, mathematical formula. It's not a sphere, it's not an ellipsoid, it's a more complicated surface. We have mountains, we have ocean bottom and so on. So it's more complicated. But for many practical applications, we need to express the figure of the heart, the shape of the heart, using formula, closed formula. For instance, when we want to produce a map of the heart, we have to write a relationship between the point on the heart and the point on the map. And this relationship has to be really clear to connect one point on the heart to one point on the map. And you can do this using formula. So we are going to see that the figure of the heart is a very complicated problem, because we have problem is a, and we mix the geometrical definition and the physical definition. So we can use some approximation. We can approximate the heart as a plane, and this is often done in geophysical application, or at least in the past. But this is true up to 10 kilometers. After, we know that we cannot approximate the heart with the plane, because we have the curvature of the heart. So we can, in first order approximation, we can approximate the heart with a sphere, but also this approximation is not so good when we are speaking about the whole hearts. So the ellipsoid of a revolution, so that means a rotation ellipsoid, rotating an ellipse around one axis, flatten of course at the poles, is the most used shape for the hearts, to describe the hearts. And we use this as an ellipsoid, as a reference surface. So, okay, this is very simple. So given an ellipsoid, we use a rotational ellipsoid. We have a very simple formulation for this type of figure that depend just by two parameters, A and B, where A and B are the semi-axis in this direction and this direction, the minimum and the maximum semi-axis. Or we can formulate this equation using one axis and the flattening or the centricity value. But as you can see, are all correlated. Related. So it means that we need just to evaluate to describe this figure, approximation figure. In this slide, now we have to fix the size of this ellipsoid, and to fix the size, which one? It depends. In the past, for many map. I'm looking for this. In the past, for many mapping application, we use this parameter, high for ellipsoid and so on. Now, with space geodesy, with GPS and so on, we use this type of values. We use a WGS 84 ellipsoid. Okay, so it's important when we use you use an ellipsoid to approximate the Earth to know which parameter are you using. For instance, in mapping is a fundamental. If I have point on the Earth that are related to an ellipsoid, it's important that I know which ellipsoid I'm using, which is the datum. To project this coordinate in the map using the correct values, the correct formula.
I'm confused about those parameters.
Okay.
They are different. How are they different?
You can see this is the time when this parameter is defined. In the past, it was not easy to give a good definition of this parameter. They improve. In the last year, we use this parameter for the space geodesy. But probably in your country, the map are not referred to this one datum, but the other one. For instance, in Italy, we switch datum in reference system, reference surface, in the last less than 10 years. So now we are producing map using this parameter, but in the past we use Hayford especially. So for catastral we use Bessel, for instance. So it's just to say, okay, geodesy mean also to give the size, but the size is a measure, is an approximation also this, and we have different values. So when we need to know the ellipsoid, you have to take attention to which ellipsoid you are using or the parameters. But this is for space geodesy now, the values used are this.
What is the importance of using the new one? What is the importance? Is this thing clear?
I suppose that these parameters are more precise than in the past, but all these parameters, to be honest, all these ellipsoids are used in a different way that we are using now. Now we are speaking about a rotational ellipsoid, geocenter. So we put the origin, the center of this ellipsoid, in the center of the Earth. In the past, we don't put the ellipsoid in the geocenter, but we approximate the surface of the Earth using a local orientated ellipsoid. So it means that I try to approximate better my country or the Europe, for instance, or a continent, not all the whole world. And okay, so they are using a different way. Okay, but this is just to introduce the connection between geometry and the gravity field. Okay, in the past we can use ellipsoid as a reference surface, but the plumb line, the line of force of the gravity field, doesn't concede. Is not equal to the normal line with respect to the ellipsoid. So we know if I have a plumb line, it's put following the gravity field. Why you can see this one? This along the line of force of the gravity field. This line is not equal to the normal to the ellipsoid. Okay.
This line is the plumb line.
Yes, we have to have a heavy mass at the end, and this following the line of force of the gravity field. But if we have an ellipsoid, the normal doesn't coincide, it's not equal. And this difference is called the flexion of the vertical. This is this angle, and usually we use two values to represent this angle in one direction and another direction, northeast and north south and east west direction. So you use two parameters, two angles to give this deflection of the vertical. But this is important because okay. It's important to introduce another surface that approximates the Earth in a better way. This surface is the geoid. The geoid is the equipotential surface of the Earth's gravity field. So it's an equipotential surface. It's related to the gravity field. When we are speaking, I told about a plane, a sphere, ellipsoid. We fixed the geometric dimension of this ellipsoid. We have seen different values of the axis of the eccentricity of the ellipsoid. We have also to fix this ellipsoid in the space, the orientation, and this is done using the stars. Okay, but in this definition, we don't use a gravity field, but for the practical point of view, when we are going to study the water or we are going to build important structure, engineering structure, what you want to know is a gravity field. So to do this we need to introduce another surface, the geoid. And the geoid starting just from the gravity field is the equipotential surface of the Earth's gravity field. We know we have a lot, but which equipotential surface? We have a lot of equipotential surface, of course, but the equipotential surface that approximate the sea level, the ocean surface. Okay, without any disturbance, we know that the ocean have a lot of tide effect, wave effect, and so on. We have also effect from the currents. The current produce like a topography of the surface of the ocean. What they call sea surface topography is due to these important currents that change the gravity, the equipotential surface. So the geoid is the equipotential surface of the gravity field that approximate the ocean, the sea surface without any disturbance. Why we use this type of equipotential surface? Because the Earth is covered by water. We have a big basin, ocean basin, so it's easy to realize this surface, to visualize the surface. Okay, so we have seen that this is the formula of the gravity potential. The gravity potential, the geoid is an equipotential surface, so it means that along the geoid, the potential is a constant, W0. This value is not known. Now, to be honest, now the geodetic community try to quantify this value in terms of constant, to say this constant is this value. But up to now, it is not important to know exactly these values. We are going to see. And now we want to know, okay, this is the Earth's surface, the topography, the mountains, the valley, and so on. This is the geoid surface, and this is the ellipsoid. Usually we are in this the relationship, but sometimes we can have geoid under the ellipsoid. But okay, usually we have in this situation. So now, with this figure, we are going to combine the two different formulations of the geodetic problem, the geometric formulation and the physical formulation, because we can define, we can say that the ellipsoidal height is this length from the point of the surface to the ellipsoid along the normal line to the ellipsoid. We define the orthometric height as the length from the point P0 on the surface to the geoid along the line of force, the normal to the geoid. And this quantity, that is the differences, the separation between these two reference surfaces, geoid and ellipsoid, is called geoid ondulation, N. And in force approximation is through this relationship, in force approximation because, okay, this is a curved line, this is a straight line, So the ellipsoidal height is given by is equal to the orthometric line plus the geoid ondulation. So in this, we are going to see that the GPS or also the other modern positioning techniques give us this quantity. But usually, when you speak about, Trieste, I suppose as 1 meter above the mean sea level. So when you speak about the altitude in the civil life, or when you look at a map, you have all the heights with respect to the sea level, the mean sea level. So we are speaking about this quantity. But from the modern technique, we obtain the ellipsoidal height. So in the last year, in the last decades, it's important to know these values, the differences between the reference surface, the ellipsoid, that is a mathematical simple surface, to the geoid, because the geoid surface is more accurate, is more approximate better the Hertz, and is the quantity that we want to know for every practical application.
The geoid and ellipsoid, they fall under the geometric formulation?
Ellipsoid as a geometric, ellipsoidal height as a geometric formulation. N is the differences. So to know N, I need to know the gravity field of the Earth, because I have to know the surface. I'm going to explain you. So in this very simple formula, we put together geometry and a physical property of the Earth.
So geoid is not under geometric formulation.
It's not just geometric. It's changed with respect to the ellipsoidal if I change ellipsoid, it change also these values. But I need to know the geoid, and the geoid is an equipotential surface, so it's a physical definition of the surface. So n, the geoid undulation, put together this is a connection, more or less, between these two quantities. You have a question?
So it is
inside.
It
depends, yes, sometimes it depends, okay. When you put this ellipsoid, this ellipsoid try to fit the Earth, and in some part of the Earth is outside, in some part is inside, it depends. For instance, in Italy, the geoid undulation change from 25 meters to 50 meters. So it means that we have the geoid is above the ellipsoid. And the ellipsoid is inside. Okay, we are speaking about meters, not kilometers. So it's quite small, but we have this variation. So, okay. This is a precise definition for the orthometric height. The orthometric height of a point P0 is the arc length of the plumb line through the point P0, between P0 and the geoid. Okay. And the ellipsoidal height is a similar formulation, but is a along the normal line to the ellipsoid. So this quantity change if you change the ellipsoid the parameter of the ellipsoid is to change the size, the orientation of the ellipsoid, the h, small h height, the ellipsoidal height change. Okay. In geodesy, we have seen that we have the gravity potential, and this is another connection between the geoid and the ellipsoid. This is the gravity potential, the actual gravity potential, so of the Earth. With this letter U, is a potential due to the ellipsoid. Ellipsoid is a simple figure. If you approximate the max of the Earth and put this max inside the ellipsoid, you say the mass of the Earth is dot values. Okay, we can compute in a simple way which is the potential of the ellipsoid. In geodesy, we use the differences between the actual potential and the normal potential. This is called normal potential, the potential due to the ellipsoid. Sorry, I think that I forgot to write some notation. This quantity is called anomalous or disturbing potential, and if you see, it's quite small, it's 10⁻⁵ with respect to the normal potential. And what we use in geodesy is the gravity anomaly, that is the differences between the gravity that we measure, for instance, on the Earth or using a gravimeter or from the space, and the gravity force predicted by the normal potential. And all the geodetic boundary value problem try to to find this anomaly, to compute this anomaly potential T. So we have seen that we have to approximate the Hertz using different surface, plane, sphere or ellipsoid. Ellipsoid is not sufficient in many applications because we have this, it's not related to the gravity field. So we have some practical problem when we use this to study a tunnel under mountains and we want to control the water and so on. And so we need a surface related to the gravity field. As this surface is a geoid because from its definition is the equipotential surface of the gravity field, one specific equipotential surface. Okay, now using the relationship between the height, the ellipsoidal orthometric height, or comparing the gravity field of the Earth with the gravity field predicted by an ellipsoid, a reference ellipsoid, we connect this geometric formulation with the physical formulation. For instance, using N, the geoid ondulation, or defining an anomalous potential. And also, in terms of gravity, introducing gravity anomaly, that is the differences between the real, the true gravity and what we are going to we measure on the Hertz, and the gravity predicted by the definition of the ellipsoid. Okay. So this representation. This is as we can see is the surface is a geoid. Is a surface related to the gravity field, and this is the potential due to a normal potential to an ellipsoid. In this case, you can see we have some part where is a very irregular surface related to the topography, but also to the masses inside the Hertz. And this is a very regular surface. Okay, so this is we have a geometry formulation with a physical formulation, but this two different approach to the problem are not completely separate because in some approximation we can not think about gravity, but in most of the application we have to put together this type of formulation. And this is, you can see in the Molodeschi boundary value problem, we have seen that we solve to study the figure as a gravity field of the Hertz, we need to solve a boundary value problem. And this is the problem that we are going to use and solve in geodesy. This is the gradient, sorry, I changed the notation, of the anomalous potential is equal zero, so it's an harmonic domain outside the Earth surface. S mean Earth surface. And this anomalous potential is related to the gravity anomaly. So it's related to our measure because we obtain this gravity anomaly subtracting the normal gravity from our observation. We can solve the boundary value problem and we can obtain the geoid ondulation because the geoid ondulation is given by the anomalous potential divided by the normal gravity. I know that it's not easy to see all of it. But just to say, from the gravity observation, I have information on geoid ondulation, for instance.
The geoid ondulation, you say it's the anomalous potential divided by what?
This is the normal gravity, the gravity due to predicted by the ellipsoid. The solution of the boundary value problem can be expressed in terms of spherical harmonic expansion. Okay, this is the definition of spherical harmonic. I think that you already know. You have the Legendre function, and these are multiplied for cosine of m lambda, it depends of or sin, it depends of the sine of m. So we have a representation. It's like an approximation. Okay. So the anomalous potential is written in terms of spherical harmonics. And in this relationship, we have the gravitational constant, universal constant, the mass of the Earth. The air means we are speaking about an anomalous potential in a point with a latitude and longitude and latitude, and air is the distance. And all this quantity we can fix. What we don't know is this term, the unknown coefficient. And we can, so the geodetic community compute this value, analyzing, for instance, the motion of the satellite and so on, and give this value through a global geopotential model or a global gravity model. For instance, in the past we have this type of model, EGM-96, now we have EGM-2008 with a different degree and order of the harmonic expansion. And when you know this coefficient, you know the anomalous potential, so you know the geoid ondulation. Okay. And this coefficient are given by the International Center for Global Hertz Model. ICGM, and this figure is not updated. Now we have a lot of model because in the last year we have a very important gravity satellite mission that give us a lot of new measure to obtain new information about the gravity field of the Earth. So there are more than this model, and you can see we have different degree, maximum degree in the expansion, and this means that we obtain information from satellite mission, for instance GOES, and these are G mean from ground data, observed gravity data from the ground, from the Earth. A mean altimetric information and so on. To obtain this model has been obtained using has been obtained combining different type of observation and so on. This you can compute using this web service to compute the joy, the ondulation, the gravity field, all these quantities are gravity functional of the anomalous potential. You have joy, the gravity anomaly, a different definition, but is not the aim of this lesson. And you can predict on a grid also in single point the values of the anomalous potential and the quantity related to the anomalous potential. This is valid for a global model, so for all the Hertz. To have a more precise joint undulation, for instance, you have to use a local joint model. For instance, this service is provided by Polytechnic of Milan University in Italy that collect local joint model. So you can find more precise model for joint undulation. These are divided from area, there is a map, you can select the zone that you are interested. Some models are public, some models are private, others are on demand, it depends by the country. Okay, finish this. Okay, now we need a break, I suppose. With this first part of the program, I have introduced you some basic information on geodesy. I know that there are a lot of information just in 1 hour, so read again the slide, study, and if you have problem, contact me. But the scheme is we need information on the figure and on the gravity field. But this information are correlated each other because the gravity field changes the figure of the Hertz. We have to solve practical problem. Use a very simple surface for our computation, but we need also to be very close to the real surface of the Hertz. So for this reason, we also need gravity measure to connect these two parts to solve practical and also physical problem on the Hertz. So, if you want, we can have a break.
Okay.
And we...
The slides you sent to our mail? The notes?
Yes, I'm going to prepare the email with the link and you prefer to
have... Will I have access to it? Will I have access to the notes?
Yes. And you prefer to have the slide before the lesson to put your notes on the slide, I suppose. you like to print the slides to write directly on the slide.
Oh, OK.